Hi, good day everybody, welcome to the ESA channel. Today we'll be having a look at the NX1300D from Kenwood. Before I go much further, I would just like to point you that Kenwood in South Africa, some models are supplied as three different items. In other words, the charger is a different box and the antenna is supplied as a different box. They don't come as one complete package like most of the other suppliers do in our country. So when you buy Kenwoods from us or in South Africa, you will see that they come as three different items. I'm not quite sure why they do this, but I assume that maybe throughout the world they have a standard radio that they send everywhere with the charger that differs from area and region, and then of course the antennas. But nevertheless, let's have a look at the Kenwood 1300D. In our case, this is a UHF, but I suppose that the VHF counterpart for this radio will be the NX2300D. This is a UHF counterpart, so the other one will possibly be 2300D. And what you see here, it is supplied in a recycled box. Minimalistic. Let's have a look when we open it up what we have inside. As you can see, just the booklet. This is a display radio from Kenwood, and I think it is one of the entry-level devices which is supplied by Kenwood in South Africa. So the cheapest one that you will get with a LCD display. Next up we have the battery. And then also we have the belt clip and dust cap for the accessories. Let's have a look at the individual items. We have the radio. And as you can see immediately what I do like about this, and it is my preference, that a belt clip is actually mounted on the chassis itself. I do like this. I've said my reasons for doing so on previous videos, but just to recap, the belt clip that is actually there to hold the radio in place is fitted to the chassis. It means if the battery fails, the battery will not dislodge itself from the radio and you lose the radio itself. So therefore, I like this design where the belt clip actually screws onto the chassis. I'm not particularly pro Kenwood, but I like this design from them. I also like the design that there is a chassis where the battery, the latch at the bottom is actually part of the metal structure, not just part of the plastic. So in other words, the battery will be kept in place. What I don't like about the Kenwoods are the fact that the latch is on the bottom. We have found that some of these actually break out. And Kenwood has changed the design on this recently. As in a few years ago, where you have to lift a little flap before you can press the knob. It becomes tricky with one hand. You need to lift the flap and then push the latch. The latch is underneath the metal part, so they sort of worked around the problem with having a latch at the bottom. But nevertheless, I don't like a design with the latch there. The one with the latch on the top is more pleasant to see. This radio also has an SMA antenna socket, so you can easily fit a external antenna. You'll see that the center knob is longer than the one on the side, thus trying to protect that one. But also what some of the other manufacturers have done by raising something on the side here, they have not done. I believe it certainly helps for when a radio gets dropped. but they may have done their research and feel different. On the side, you have the dust cap that covers the audio accessories. And in this case, it's a normal standard Kenwood type accessory. Let's see what the battery looks like. The battery supplied with this device is standard, is a KENWOOD NX1300d. It is used on a few models, and in this case it is a 2000 milliamp battery, 7.4 volt. I like that they have increased the size of the battery. It solves a lot of problems, especially with longer shifts, and maybe if you use lots of lights and a radio with a display, obviously charges a bit more energy than your normal device not having a display. So it is good that they increase the battery size. I don't know if a 2000 is good enough for an 8-hour shift, but there you go. A bigger battery than the normal equipment, maybe about 60% bigger. The battery clips in on the top and then just snaps in at the bottom. It seems to have a secure fit, slightly loose, but nothing serious. The recent design on the TK2000s is actually a more snugger fit than this one. So if I can be critical, it is possibly that this battery does not feel 100% secure, like they have improved with the TK2000 design. Let's have a look at the antenna that they supplied us. The antenna is a KRA27, which is a normal wideband UHF antenna. And with Kenwood, be sure that they are supplying you with the correct split. The antennas come in three different splits. This one does not seem to be marked, but I seem to recall that they are only a specific frequency. In this case, it's a 440 to 490 meg antenna. So do make sure when you order these that you order the correct split. This does not do the whole split. So if you have a frequency maybe sitting at 429 or 430, you may have a problem using this antenna, as it is not a trimmable antenna, but they come in three splits. Yes, nice branding on the antenna. I don't know if you can see it with the camera there. We do have the Kenwood branding on the antenna with a nice little tip. Okay, fitting the antenna before we switch the radio on. The reason I do that is that some radios, especially the digital radios, will transmit maybe to locate a tower. I'm not sure if these are unprogrammed or not, so therefore I'll be safe and rather fit the antenna. I don't know if I've mentioned it, but this is a digital radio. It can be programmed as analogue as well, but it is a digital radio. Upon power on, it says that it is unprogrammed, so I won't be able to access anything in the menu or on the screen. So yeah, this will be the review of the radio. Let's have a look at the charger. Before I look at the charger, the battery, you will see that the belt clip is a metal belt clip, and that part is plastic, fairly standard. And we also have the plastic dust cap, or rubber dust cap I would say. There should be a rubber dust cap in the package. I see that this part is a retainer clip which they supply. Once you have an audio accessory in there, the retainer clip is used to screw in there and keep the audio accessory snugly fit. The problem with all the devices similar to this, especially this type of design, is that you don't have a snug fit. It tends to wear out. becomes intermittent and eventually fails, it does cost the customer dearly to bring the device back. The warranty would not cover such a thing, but that item must be replaced. So therefore, Kenwood came up with an idea like this, which seems to cure the problem by, once you've fitted your adapter, fit that in, screw it down, and the problem is basically solved. Good. Let's have a look at the charger that they sent with this device. In this case, it is a KSC43. They say it is a rapid charger, and the E would probably say or indicate that it's a European plug fitted to it. We take the booklet out. We will find my much loved 2-pin plugs, which I certainly hate with a passion. And unfortunately, Kenwood has got a dedicated little connector there. It is dedicated to only Kenwood devices. You find them on some other equipment, but they are not easily to find from a normal electronic shop. Having a look at the charger, it's a 15-volt DC charger, which I do have a problem with. You cannot easily make a DC cord for your car. So that is problematic. Having a look at the charger base itself, we find that it is a nice charger. I like this charger. It tells you that it requires 15 volt. I don't know if these will work on 12 volt. I seem to recall that we have tried that in the past, but the battery does not charge fully complete. Okay. I see that there's a note on here that it is, when it's complete, it is flashing green. The reason for that is probably because green indicates a status of just being on and plugged in. But we'll find that out. The latches on the side are not very thick. I've seen thicker ones on other devices. And the slots on the side are also very thin. But I've never experienced the problem with the Kenwood radios not being able to slot in. Some other manufacturers suffer from that. So they may not require to make them thicker. Okay, so if we get closer to a mains outlet, we see if you fit this, there is no indication of power. Is it on? Is it off? I do have a problem with that, guys. I do have a problem with that. And the reason being, you never know whether there is actually power or not. I'll just put it back in again and we'll see if it shows us that it's charging or not, that there's power or not. And yes, that is not great. I don't like that. The simple reason being, you never know if the transformer is actually faulty, if your multi-plug is connected or something similar. I like it when you plug the device in, even if it just flashes for a second, portion of a second. This is not good. It means if the battery is faulty and it does not charge anymore, you could end up doing fault finding for the next half an hour. Often customers will just then phone you and say the thing is broken. You get your site just to find out that there are no mains. Yeah, I do not like that. It does indicate nice steady red when it's charging. I like that. It is good. And it is a fairly nice fit. There you go. That will be the review of the Kenwood NX1300D, which is a digital radio. It certainly has a analog mode as well, which you can program, but I think this is entry level from Kenwood. So if you're looking for a device, entry level, which you want to migrate to digital later on, this is it. And there you go, nice fit in the hand. It feels a bit bulkier because it's larger than the other radios, it's quite thick. So it for someone with small hands, this may feel big. But there you go. Actually, very nice. You have the light on top, which obviously indicates transmit and receive, which is nicely part of the design. And then also, what I forgot to say is we've got the side buttons, a PDT button, and two side buttons, which is programmable, which are, those are rubber and that is plastic. The plastic design has proven to be a problem in the past, where sometimes they bash it against something and it breaks. And often it means that it is difficult to replace that part. I don't know what it looks like inside, but there you go. That is the review of the NX1300 radio. Thanks for watching. Make sure you subscribe and like my videos so that you can see when the new ones are available.